Hello, everyone. Welcome to Talk About It Thursdays. Let me know when you're on. I am your host, Karen Bailey. I would love to say hello to you. I'll give you guys just a few minutes to come on, and then we'll get started for today. Hello, hello. Hey, Andrew. What's up? What's up, brother-in-law? Good to see you. Good to see you. Hey, Chick. Good to see you. Hope you guys are having a wonderful week. Yeah. Chick, congratulations on your baby and all her accolades as a teacher. She's an amazing young lady. So proud of her. So proud of her. I've watched you raise her, you know, and that's just a beautiful thing when, you know, you put all that hard work in and you see the reward, you know, for your due diligence. And that's what we want to talk about today. Just being a parent and, you know, putting forth that effort that we all need to do. You know, children are a blessing. They're a gift from God. Yes, it's hard work. You know, children and raising children is going to be the hardest job I think any parent is going to have. And that's mother and father. You know, it takes two. A lot of times to raise these kids. And even when you can't have two, you know, it's still a lot of work. Still a lot of work. All right, guys, let's get started because, you know, I like to give y'all time to be with your families. Our topic today is just simply called Give Them Back. And when I say give them back, I'm talking about giving your children back to God, you know, to their original father. You know, a lot of times we don't think about, you know, how they're our children, but they're God's children first. And a lot of times we forget about that and we try to take on things and we try to direct their lives in the way that they may not need to go. It may not be God's plan for them. So we have to be mindful that, yes, they're my children, but at the same time, they came from God and originally He is their father, and He's going to be the person that they're going to lean on for the rest of their life. So we want to talk about giving them back to God, dedicating your children back to God. You know, a lot of times we try to, you know, make our children do this and do that. A lot of times all we need to do is pray to God and take our hands off some things. A lot of times we make things 10 times worse just meddling ourselves. Sometimes God has to let them bump their head a little bit. You know, we hate to see them be hurt in any kind of way, but that's how we learned. You know, we learned the stove was hot because we were being disobedient and touching a stove, and we had to learn it for ourselves. No matter how much our parents tried to protect us, we had to learn some things for ourselves. And God is faithful. God is kind. He's just, you know, He knows just how far to let our children go before He snatches them back. You know, and sometimes we don't understand why God doesn't intervene, you know, faster than He does. You don't have to understand, simply because that's His child. He's got them on loan to us while we're here, but He is their original father. So we've got to remember that, and we've got to remember to talk to God about our children. We've got to remember to consult with God about our children. It's not all about us. You know, God has a plan for them just like He has a plan for us. So we don't want to get in the way and try to direct our children and manipulate our children to go a way that God may not have for them to go. Just like He's predestined our lives, He's also predestined our children's lives. So we need to give them back to God, and we also need to give our children back to their childhood. You know, so much is going on right now. It's frightening. You know, I don't know how young parents are doing things now. It's so much out there, so much more than when we were younger. You know, and it's a lot of things that have to be explained. It's a lot of things that are being accepted. It's a lot of things that are being introduced, you know, to our children. You know, when we were little, we didn't have to worry about somebody bringing a gun to school and shooting us and us not being able to go home. We didn't have to worry about, you know, is this bathroom for a boy, this bathroom for a girl? You know, you have to say this name this way or call them this, call them that. these children have so much against them right now. So that's why this topic is so important. We've got to give our children back to God, because this world is losing its mind, basically. This world is doing what the Bible says it was going to do. It's getting worse and worse and worse. So we have to give our children back to God, because He's the only one that can protect them. He's the only one that can guide them in the way that they need to go. It's our job to do the best that we can, and we are to use the wisdom that God has given us. But at the end of the day, give your children back to God. When you're frustrated, when you're tired, when you don't understand what's going on with them, when you're worried about them at night, you know, give them back to God. Pray to God that He keeps His hand on them. Pray to God that He keeps His angels of protection around them. God is faithful. He was faithful with us, you guys. Think about all the stuff that we could have gotten into. Think of all the places we were that we weren't supposed to go, and just somehow, God protected us. No, somebody was praying for us, you guys. And we have to remember that we have to stand in the gap for our children. Those things our children don't understand about the spiritual world, it is our job as their physical parents, as their earthly parents, to stand in the gap for them. You may not know everything. All you need to know how to do is pray. You may not know every scripture in this Bible. You may not know every name of every prophet, every this, every that, but that's not important. That's why your relationship with God as a parent is so important, because you're not only fighting for you, you're fighting for your children. And God had to teach me that, you know, as I was getting older and I was trying to raise my sons, you know, and I was frustrated, you know, because a lot of times a single mom doesn't understand things that are going on with our children's, the frustrations they go through at school and frustrations with their friends, this, that, and the other. And we're really quick to try to chalk it up as them having a bad attitude. A lot of times it's not a bad attitude. Sometimes those spirits are warring with them. And while you're looking on the outside saying, oh, so-and-so's in a bad mood today, so-and-so, you know, woke up on the wrong side of the bed. No, you need to start praying for your child. You don't know what spirits are attacking your child. They don't tell us everything, y'all. And you know what? We didn't tell our parents a lot of stuff. It was a lot of stuff coming against us. We never spoke up. There was a lot of things coming against us, and we suffered in silence. That's why we have to stand in the gap for our children. That's why we have to be the warriors for our children. No, will it stop everything from happening to them? No, you can't protect them from everything, but you can go to the throne on their behalf until they get strong enough to go for themselves. And even when they get grown and they learn how to do it for themselves, don't ever stop praying for them, because it's always something waiting just around the corner, just like it is for us. You know all the things we as adults go through on a daily basis. You can start your day off good, happy, exciting, and you know what? Next thing you know, that booger done come up and just knock the wind out of your sail. So just imagine if that happens to you as an adult, what is happening to our children when they're trying to belong, when they want their friends to like them, when they want everybody on social media to like them. Can you imagine all the different spirits that are attacking our children just simply from them wanting to belong, from them wanting everyone to like them, and from them wanting to feel like they're enough? That's enough right there for you to pray about, because a lot of things happen in our children's life because they're trying to fit in, because they don't want to be the outsider. They don't want to be the one left behind. So we have to stand in the gap for our children, because we do not know all the things that they face. We do not know all the different emotions they are going through. I wish as a young lady my mother knew a fourth of the things I was going through. She had no idea the things I was going through, and I didn't know how to handle them. I didn't know how to fight in the spirit. I didn't know anything about that. I didn't know anything about, you know, principalities or anything like that, and casting down thoughts and imaginations and stuff. My thoughts were all over the place. It was a constant battle when I look back over my life as a young lady, and even as a child. You know, things were attacking me left and right, and that doesn't change. That doesn't change. Don't rush or wish for your children to get older too fast. you know, young mothers, I'll tell anybody, slow down. Quit pushing your children to move forward so fast. Hey, Kinsley. Hey, Yvette. Don't push them to move so fast, because you're going to look back and you're going to wish that they were back at that age again. You're going to wish you could hold them again. You're going to wish you could watch them do those first steps again. You could teach them those first words again. A lot of times, you know, society has us rushing our children because everything is so expensive. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You know, when they're little, you got to worry about formula, daycare, diapers. You know, it's almost like it's a burden, but that's not what God intended for children to be. But that's what society tries to make them, to us, a burden. And therefore, we won't teach them things of the Spirit because we're too busy trying to survive. And that's what the enemy wants you to be, distracted. When your children are little, that's the time to teach them those things. That's the time to teach them about how to love one another, how to share, how to be someone's friend, how to be there for somebody else. Teach them those things while they're little. You know, a lot of times we're rushing them, you know, trying to get them into school, you know, because you want them out of daycare, you want them out of diapers, you want them potty trained. And a lot of times we haven't taught them anything before we push them into the school system. And then we rely on the teachers to do everything for our little kindergartners. You know, I've got friends that are teachers of these little children. You'd be amazed at the things those little children tell them about what's going on in their home. You know, you're not teaching them what they need to know to take every individual step. All we want to do is rush them and move them forward so that they're less of a burden on us. And that's the enemy that makes us not cherish our children when they're young and not do those things that we need to do. Oftentimes, we spend time worrying more than we do enjoying our children. You know, we think we have to get everything right. I know I was one of those, you know, I was like, okay, what am I missing? What am I doing wrong? Every time they did something wrong, it fell back on me for some reason. No, that was a learning experience for them. But you have to be careful about what you make your God, because, you know, trying to be a good parent, sometimes we put that up on a pedestal instead of just learning how to love your children. There's not a manuscript for that. Be careful about putting that on a pedestal and making that your idol, that you've got to be a perfect parent. Your child got to be perfect. Your child can't make no mistakes, this, that, and the other. You make those things an idol in your life. And instead of letting your child be an individual, let them learn, let them bump their head, let them make mistakes. Help them to learn from their mistakes. You know, we can't focus so much on how that reflects on me. Oh, it makes me look like I'm a bad parent. No, you're not a bad parent. You're just a parent with a child that's growing. You know, your child may need a little bit more structure. Your child may need a little bit of something over here. But that doesn't make you a bad parent. So don't let being this perfect parent be your bar that you're at, because you're going to miss something. You're going to miss something trying to reach some kind of standard, you know, so that everybody can look up to you. Don't do that. It's an individual thing. No child is the same. I don't care if you have 20 of them. None of them are going to be the same, and you can't treat them all the same. You love them the same, but you cannot treat them all the same. So don't cut out this cookie cutter idea of what a parent is supposed to be and how a child is supposed to be and expect everybody to fall into that mold, because you're going to lose somebody. You're going to lose them trying to make them be a certain way instead of allowing them to be who they need to be and helping them to develop and grow so that they'll move those things in a positive direction, so they'll become the kind of person that they can be proud of. You know, so many of us, you know, growing up, we weren't happy with the person we saw in the mirror. You know, we had everything wrong to say about the person that was in the mirror simply because nobody nurtured us. Nobody guided us along the way. Nobody told us we were beautiful or that we were handsome. You know, it was not something that was commonplace, but we need to fix that. We need to fix that, because a poor self-image will lead to poor behavior. And if you don't recognize that your child doesn't love who he is early on in life, they're going to make a bunch of big mistakes trying to figure out who they are or trying to be something that they're not. So you can't worry about being this perfect parent, and you're going to miss out on the little things, the little subtle hints that are going to be so important that you pay attention to and you stay in tune with. No, you won't be perfect. Yes, you're going to make some mistakes. Some things are going to work. Some things aren't. But you need to get in tune with your child wherever that child is. How much time are you spending praying for your children? Ask yourself that. In a day, how much time do I spend? And I'm not talking about you got to fall all over your children and grease them down with oil and do all of that. I'm not talking about that ritualistic stuff. I'm talking about just having them in your thoughts and saying, God, protect my child today. God, be with him. He's got a test today. God, be with her. You know, her friends were mean to her yesterday. God, you know, just keep them in your thoughts throughout the day. Pray for them before they leave the house. Pray for them when they come home. Pray for them, you know, before they go to bed. Pray for them when they wake up. It doesn't have to be some long ritualistic prayer, but you have to understand we have to keep them covered at all times, because the enemy is always looking for just a small opening. He's going to squeeze through the smallest opening. So we've got to keep them covered in prayer, you guys. And it's just a matter of understanding that this world is not for them. It's not for them. This world is against our children, simply because that is the time when the enemy strikes them the most. It's when they're young, when they're early, before they become fully mature. He wants to get them while they're young. Some of us can recognize that he came after us when we were young, before we knew better. Let me put it like that. I won't even say spiritual. Before you knew better, there were some things that you had in your mind, some things that you did that you knew were wrong, and you didn't know where those thoughts came from. Guess what? The enemy was putting those thoughts in your mind while you're young. He likes to get you while you're young before anybody can mold you and shape you. And that has not changed. That has not changed. Because if he can throw you off as a child, then he can design the direction that you go. If somebody doesn't step in and be there for you, somebody doesn't step in and say, hey, okay, this child has been through some things. Hey, this child has been abused. Hey, this child doesn't have the best home environment. Let me start mentoring this child. Let me start spending some time with him. Let me start putting this child in a different type of environment. Let him see different things. Let her see that it doesn't have to be like that. You know, if somebody doesn't step in and recognize that you need help at a young age, it does shape, you know, the rest of your life. It shapes those years that you're forming. That you're forming your ideas, that you're forming your personality. Those things are getting formed, and the enemy likes to get you in the developmental stage. Because if he can get you off and all off key in the developmental stage, there's a better chance of you staying that way throughout the rest of your life. There's a better chance, and that's what he wants. When we think about, you know, how so many times people that can't have children, they seem so desperate to have a child. And what's funny is people that can easily have children, we don't think anything of it. But I think about Hannah in the Bible, you know, how important her having a child was to her. And she not only wanted a child, she asked for a man child, a male child. But one thing she petitioned God for, she said, I tell you what, if you give him to me, I'll give him back to you for the rest of his life. And that's how we have to treat our children. When God gives us a child, give him back to God for the rest of his life. Yes, he's going to always need you. Yes, he's going to always love you. But there's going to be some things you can't do for them. There's going to be a lot of things that they can't call mama and daddy for. They're going to have to rely on God. So you have to dedicate them at a young age and let the enemy know this is God's child. This is not my child. This is God's child. So when you mess with him, you are going to have to deal with God. Give them back to God, because God is going to step in where you can't even figure out what to do. When things will start working out and you don't even know how it worked out, that was God. That was God. So let's give our children back to God. Start dedicating your children to them. People do it when their children are small, but you don't even have to do it when they're small. Do it now. Whatever age they are, dedicate those children back to God. And then make a commitment to be the best parent you could possibly be. And then have peace in knowing that your children have someone besides a flawed you. Somebody besides know-it-all you, somebody that ain't got it all together. They got somebody else besides you that they can call on for strength. They got somebody that they can call on that they know can make a way out of no way. And that's what we want for our children, okay? Teach your children how to be grateful and be positive role models. That's something we got to start teaching our children. So many of these children are so ungrateful. They take things for granted. They don't have to do without. They don't say please. They don't say thank you. We have fallen off, you guys. We have fallen off. My mama was not the best mother in the world, but I tell you what, you better say yes, ma'am, no, ma'am, and you better say please and thank you. Better. And somewhere along the line, I don't know when it happened, all of that became old-fashioned. People said, oh, he don't have to call me ma'am. Oh, she don't have to call me sir. Yes, she does. She better. No, you don't call a grown person by their first name. No. We're letting our children grow up way too fast, y'all. Somebody's got to take control and say enough is enough. You know, so many times, you know, when I was little, I remember, you know, us trying to run into a room where there was grown-ups talking, and they sent us out of that room. Y'all need to start sending some of these kids out of the room. They know too much. They hear too much. They're growing up too fast, you guys. Help them to stay in a child's place. You have the power to do that. It is not okay for your children to be your best friend. That is weird. That is strange. That is not God's design, you know, for our relationship with our children. It's one thing when they're adults for you to be somewhat of a friend, but your child should never be your best friend. It should never be like that. Because as long as you live, you will always be in a hierarchy as that child's parent, and that needs to remain in order. It needs to remain in order, or disrespect is coming. You've got to keep things in the order that God has placed them in, okay? And then teach your children how to pray. They're not too young. None of them are too. When they learn how to say those first words, that's a prayer. Teach them a prayer when they first start saying, before they say words, put those hands together, sit them at the table, don't give them nothing until they do it, make them bow their heads. You can teach those children how to pray. From the very beginning. Children are smart. They pick up on everything. Make it a priority because they're going to need it. They're going to need it. So often, these children that are out here in the streets doing this and that, nobody's taught them that there was somebody higher than them. Nobody taught them that there was somebody that loved them no matter what they do. You know, it's something missing in this generation of children that think nothing about taking another child's life. It's something wrong, you guys, and we got to take things back. I don't care if my kids are grown. Every time I get an Amber Alert, got one today, it broke me to tears because that is somebody's child missing, somebody's child abducted. It's not okay for me to only pray for mine. I got to pray for everybody's child. Everybody's child is important. So, guys, we've got to start doing better about doing what we need to do as adults, doing what we need to do as parents, because the enemy is doing his job. We see it every day on the news. He is on his job. He gets there early and he stays late. We're the only ones that's failing at our job, you guys. And it doesn't matter if you don't have children. You know children. You have family members that are children. You know, there's always an opportunity for you to pray for a child. And we've got to do that. We've got to start covering these children. We are losing them left and right. We're losing them to the prison system, you guys. We are losing them. And it's our fault because we allowed everything to slide on by. We allowed everything. We fussed about it for a minute. but we allowed it to go on by. Well, my daughter don't like for her kids to pray. Okay, well, you know what? I don't care what she want. If they around me, they gonna learn how to pray. And I would go total no with her about that, because somebody probably prayed for her. Somebody prayed for you, so now you don't want your children to pray. Oh, you want them to find their own religion. While they looking, I'm going to be praying for them. So we have to take authority as a parent and a grandparent and start praying for our children, you guys. Teach them how to volunteer. Teach them how to give back instead of taking all the time. So many people only know how to take. We know adults, y'all, that could only take. They don't want to give nothing. Anytime it's time for them to give, they disappear. It's because nobody taught them that it's better to give than it is to receive. Nobody taught them what a blessing it is to give and to pour out to somebody else. Somewhere down the line, something was missed. Something was missed in their life. And they don't understand the blessing they're missing by being a giver. It's so much you get from giving to others, from pouring out to others, from sharing with others. It's a blessing in itself. God will heap blessings on top of you simply because you're pouring out. So guess what? He's not going to leave you empty. He's going to fill you back up. But if nobody's ever taught you that, you go around and take and take and take. Your hands are full all the time because you're trying to get as much as you can while you can. And that's no way to live. They're never happy because nothing is ever enough. Okay? And then are you willing to pay it forward and bless somebody else's child? You know, I got the opportunity, one of my nursing jobs was at Tyler Junior College. And I got an opportunity to see children that had never been away from home. And it's funny, some of them used to come to the clinic with all these fake pains and aches and stuff, simply because they missed their mother. Simply because they wanted me to mother them. Simply because they wanted me to love on them. You know, you have to pay it forward, because while you're doing well for somebody else's child, while you're blessing somebody else's child, guess what? God is going to make sure that somebody blesses your child. And I firmly believe it, because all while I was taking care of those TJC babies that weren't mine, God was taking care of my children. And so I know that it's true, that if you will pay it forward and you'll bless other people's children, you'll bless your nieces, your nephews, you know, they don't have to even be related to you, but bless somebody else's child, because you don't know what that child is missing at home. And it's not your job to speculate, but it is your job to be sensitive to what you see and what you feel about that child. And you try to give that child the best that you can while they're around you. You know, you don't have to get all in their business, but if you sense they need love, put your arm around them. If you sense they need somebody to talk to, let them know that you're an ear, that if they ever need to talk to you, you know, they can call you, or they can ask you to meet them somewhere and sit down and talk somewhere. You don't ever know what they need, but make yourself available. Ask yourself, what are you willing to sacrifice for your child so that they can have a better chance at a happy life and a whole life? One, we ain't talking about material things, because those things can't always make you happy, and they sure can't make you whole. Two, are you giving them a religious foundation and recognizing that church is not a babysitter? You don't use your church as a babysitter simply because you got something else to do. Oh, vacation Bible school. Okay, I'm going to drop them off. I got all this free time. I can go hang out and go do this and do that. No, what kind of example are you setting? Church is not a babysitter. That is where your children get their foundation for what they're going to need in their life, so that they can build up their spiritual muscles, so they can fight the things that are coming against them in this world. And you need to be there fighting beside them. They need to see you there too, because you're the one that's supposed to be stronger than them. A lot of these kids are having to pray for their parents. They got more spirituality than their parents, and that's sad, because that is not the order of things. But sometimes it's true, it's happening. And we talked about teaching them how to pray and how to have a relationship with God. And that means you're going to have to sacrifice some of your time. You're going to have to sacrifice your time and read to those children. Help them understand their Bible. Help them with the questions that they have. And if you don't have to have the answers, you need to find someone that does. You need to find someone that does. And then you need to go to church with them. Don't just drop them off. Go to church with them. Go as a family. Go as a unit so that they can see that relationships with God and with other people are just as important to you as you try to make it seem like it's supposed to be to them. You make them get up and go. So why is it not important for you to go? They need to see you being the example. They need to see you being the spiritual leader of your house. And then help them understand when the world is confusing around them. Because it's confusing. I'm confused. I'm 54 years old. I am very confused. So I can only imagine what these children are thinking and all the misinformation these children have gotten. Watching the news and they spin all this stuff and tell you this is right and it's okay to do this, it's okay to do that. These children are confused. So somebody's got to be there to help guide them in the right direction. And that's nobody's job but ours, you guys. That's nobody's job but ours. Are you willing to spend time just talking to your children? And that requires a sacrifice. That means you got to stop doing what you're doing and sacrifice your time to be there so your child can have a conversation. And that child needs to feel like whatever they talk to you about, they're not going to get in trouble. Or that you're not going to mistreat them for what they say or what they share with you or punish them for what they share with you. It's got to be an open dialogue, not I told you not to do this. I told you not to do that. You want to listen to see exactly what their friends are doing, you know, because her friends influence a lot, you guys. So you want to know what's going on in your child's life. But if they feel like they can't talk to you, all you do is fuss. All you do is talk about how hard you work and you tired of this and you tired of that. That child is not going to open up to you. And then you're going to wonder why he likes to talk to Uncle so-and-so or he likes to talk to Aunt so-and-so. Because she sacrifices her time. She makes time, quality time, to make sure that child has somebody to talk to in this confusing world. And then another sacrifice, will you get healthy? Will you sacrifice doing some stuff you like to do? Will you sacrifice doing all that drinking, doing all that smoking, doing all that partying? And get healthy and be home for your children and make your children a priority so that you can be there for them and be there in the future for your grandkids. You know, you've got to make some decisions to give up some stuff. You know, when we have children, you know, a lot of people say, I'm still young. I'm still do all that stuff after you get your children raised. But it is not their job to let you try to grow up with them. That is not their job. They need a parent now. They don't need a parent later. They need a parent now. You brought them in the world. That means you got to make some sacrifices. That means you got to decide, I have another life I'm responsible for. I can't do what everybody else do. And I promise you, it won't kill you. That stuff will still be out there if you want to do it 18 years later. I promise it's going to be 10 times worse, so you're going to have 10 times more fun. So recognize the fact that those children need all of you. They need you all in, is what I'm trying to say. They need you all in, not halfway being a parent and then trying to be something else because you've missed out on your youth. No, they need you to be a parent 24/7 because they need everything that you've got in order to make it in this world, in order to get that foundation that they need to step outside that door and be an adult on their own. You know, a lot of times we talk about kids that fail and end up having to come back home or just don't seem to be doing well out there. Something got missed. Most of the time, something got missed and they were not prepared for that world that was out there. It's like you throw them out there and you shut the door and you lock it and you say, survive the best way you can. That's not fair because you know that there are some things that you didn't teach him. You know there are some things that you didn't show your child to get them ready for what was waiting for them out there. And that's what's happening to a lot of our children. You know, they're adults, but they're children in their mind because they didn't mature. Nobody helped them mature and develop into adults. It's one thing to be an adult in number, your age, but it's a whole different world to be an adult in your mind. And y'all know what I'm talking about, because y'all know people that are adults in their age and just as silly and just as childish they want to be. Somewhere something got left behind. Nobody helped them develop into the person that they needed to be. And it's time out for that, you guys. We've got to do better. We've got to do better with trying to help people be the best version of themselves. And we've got to start with our children. We've got to start with our children. Hey, Renita. Make sure I say hi to everybody. Hey, Kinsley. Okay. And then, are you willing to make sure your child has a safe environment? And a safe environment means you may have to move from where you're living if you know it's not safe. If it's a neighborhood that you have to worry all the time. If it's a neighborhood where the child can't even get a good night's sleep. It's time to move. And I know that's easier said than done, but you need to at least be having it on your mind. You need to at least be formulating a plan so that you can live better. And sometimes it means you're going to sacrifice. You may sacrifice space. You may sacrifice having a yard. You may sacrifice, you know, going to a certain school just to be in a safe environment so your child can have some peace, so your child can grow up and develop as a child and not feel like they got a rush to get older just to survive, just to protect the family because it's so bad out there. You know, they can't even play and have a good time and be a child. They have to be aware of everything all the time. That's got to be a horrible existence for these children. And I think about some of the movies I've seen on TV. You know, when me and my sister and one of our friends went to New York, you know, they were telling us about these projects and this, that, and the other, and just how these kids, they have to be grown so fast because it's a matter of life and death. You know, they got to know when to run. They got to know who not to fool with. They got to know when something is about to jump off. You know, I don't understand how they even are expected to grow up to be decent human beings living in that type of an environment. That is just like Wild Kingdom. You got to protect yourself at all times. You know, how do you develop as a child when you're in fear all the time? So we've got to provide a safe environment, whatever that takes, you guys, to get our children in a safe environment where they can develop, where they can learn, and where they can grow into good human beings and people with positive self-image. And when our children are being bullied at school, what are we doing about it? Are we just keeping them in that same school? Nothing is changing. Those same kids are messing with our children. You know, the principal's not doing everything they need to do. You know, sometimes we got to move our kids. Yes, it's an inconvenience. Yes, it is. But sometimes you got to get them out of that environment if nothing is changing. If nothing is changing, don't keep allowing your child to suffer like that. Get your child, move that child out of that environment. That's why so many people are homeschooling, you guys. And I get it. If my child was being bullied, if my children were still little and somebody was bullying my child at the school, you know, and nobody seemed to care and nobody seemed to be making that stop, and my child had this anxiety and fear and all of that, he can't learn. She can't learn like that. You can't expect them to learn when they're watching their back all the time, when they're worrying about people whispering about them and mistreating them and pulling them into dark corners and doing stuff to them. You know, take that child out. If you got to homeschool that child, homeschool them so that they can be in a safe environment and get what they need. We are missing so much with our children. We are missing out, you guys. And I'm sure I missed out on a lot when I was raising mine. And I don't have grandchildren at this point. But I pray to God that he gives me the ability to see, hey, Kathy, to see when something is going on with that child so that I can start praying. So I can start praying for whatever it is that that child be covered. You know, we've got to pay more attention to them. Kids give us signs, but a lot of times we're too busy, we're too tired, we're too busy trying to get that bag, working 2 and 3 jobs so we can drive this kind of car, live in this kind of house, and our children are suffering for it because we put the material things above raising our children sometimes. So we've got to get our focus back on the children because the world is eating our children up. And then learn to monitor your child's social media. That's also part of a safe environment. Don't let them be all over the place doing this and doing that and on every search engine. You know, you giving them phones and this, that, and the other, you know, where they can do things in private. As a parent, it is your job to know what's going on with your child. You are not to be their friend. You are there to keep them safe. And like I said before, be present so that they can talk to you when something is going on. And recognize when your children suddenly change. You know, a lot of times people don't understand that when that child changes all of a sudden, something has happened. Don't just write it off. Don't just say, oh, you know, they had a bad day. Oh, if you don't know that for sure that that's it, you need to find out what's going on because children will show you when something traumatic has happened to them. You know, their whole mood will change. Their whole attitude will change. You know, so many people have missed their children being molested, you know, because they chalked up that to, oh, you know, she's in a bad mood or I don't know what's wrong with her. She must have got into a fight with one of her friends. Okay, you are making all these excuses except for trying to find out what's going on with your child and you're missing something happening right up under your nose. Pay attention to the signs and ask God to show you those signs. Even when those children aren't talking to you, ask God to show you what's going on with your child. And he will do it because he's showing me things that was going on with mine. And they asked me how I knew and I couldn't even tell them how I knew. It just came to me. But that's what happens when you involve God in the parenting, when you recognize that those children belong to God, you give those children back to God, God will help you raise those children. He will. You're going to miss some stuff, but I promise you, he's going to make sure you catch that big stuff because he let me catch the big stuff. And I thank God for it every day. And then another part of a safe environment for our children is removing toxic people from around your kids. It is not important that you have a man if your children don't feel safe. Ladies, do not put your happiness, your desire for a companion above your children's safety and well-being. It is not right. It is not fair. And God is not pleased. Because one thing about it, those children are yours first. They come before any man. God gave you those children, so it is your job to make sure that nobody hurts them. It's your job that they're not afraid in their own home. There are children literally afraid in their own home. You're letting other people discipline your children. Stop letting people discipline your children. They don't have the same love for your child as you do. It is not okay for your boyfriend to discipline your child. He does not have the same love for your child. So please, ladies, it is not that important. God literally allowed me to be by myself those last 5 years I was raising my youngest son. And I thank God for that because God put it in my spirit that because of the toxic relationships that they've already had to endure, they need some time to reset. And my son needed time to reset after what he saw me go through. And it was more important to me that my child got the healing that he needed than for me to have a man in my house. And I thank God every day for that revelation. Was it easy? No, ma'am. It was not. But you know what? It was worth it. It was worth it because I gave my child time to heal. I even gave my oldest time to heal from things I didn't know that he was struggling with simply because they were hurting because they watched what I was going through. And all they wanted was for their mama to be safe and their mama to be who she used to be. My youngest son told me, Mama, you know, he said, I didn't know who you were for a while. I was tired of you being sad. You know, children feel what you feel. You are not sheltering them from anything. When your children love you, they feel what you feel. It is not okay to stay in a toxic relationship because you're not the only one that's hurting. And I had to learn this lesson for myself. You're not the only one that's hurting. And a lot of times kids won't tell you what they're thinking and what they're feeling, those fears, those anxieties that they have, because they don't want to hurt your feelings or they don't want to upset you. But that toxic relationship is hurting you and it's hurting your children. Recognize it, do something about it, and put your children first. That's all I'm going to say on that. Because God had to put that in my spirit, and I had to sacrifice, and I thank God for it every day, because while they were getting healed, guess what? Simultaneously, I was getting healed, because I had never been out of a relationship that long. I had never been by myself that long, but I needed that even for myself. So sometimes God will allow things, and you think you're doing it for them, but God is really doing it for you. And I thank him for that every day. But put your children first, okay? Even if that means no relationship, let those children heal. Let them children grow. Help them develop into who they need to be. You can have your relationship later, okay? Your loneliness is not your children's problem, okay? Hear me again. Your loneliness and your need for companionship is not your child's problem. So quit making it their problem. Quit making it their burden. Because when you bring the wrong people into your house, you not only burden yourself down, but you burden those children down. You're burdening them down. So start thinking about those things and ask God to show you the people that are in your life. Show you if those people are good to be around your children or not. He'll show you. And then you got to make the sacrifice and say, you know what? My children are worth more than this. My children deserve better than this. I'm going to have to leave so-and-so alone for a while. If it's meant for me and him to be back together after I get my kids grown, so be it. If not, I appreciate the relationship, but you are not healthy for my children. And you've got to make those type of sacrifices if you want your children to be healthy and whole. The next sacrifice you got to make is swallowing your pride. You know, you got to swallow your pride and ask for help sometimes. You know, sometimes people, you know, they're so hell-bent on not letting anybody know what's going on with them, don't want nobody to know their business. And sometimes your help is right outside the door, but you're so busy trying to keep everything that goes on in this house, better stay in this house. Y'all done heard it. And a lot of times you need some help because you don't know what you're doing. But you've got to be willing to ask for help. People aren't going to bombard you. People aren't going to just push you out the way. No, they don't want to deal with your attitude. So you've got to put your pride aside when it comes to your children. If you need something, you need to ask for it. If your children need something that you cannot provide, you need to ask for it. And I'm not talking about material things either. I'm talking about a skill that you don't have. I'm talking about a quality in you that you just don't have. You're not mature. Then you need to make sure your children around people that are mature, because you don't want them to end up making the same silly mistakes that you're making. You know, so swallow your pride and ask for help when you don't have answers. Ladies, when it comes to raising these boys, you are not going to have all the answers. Trust me, I don't care how good of a parent you think you are doing it by yourself. Oh, women can raise boys. Yes, you can, but you are going to need some men in your life that can speak to those boys, that can speak to the inner child in that boy. A woman can't speak to the boy in him. I promise you, she cannot. It's going to take a man to speak to the boy inside of a boy and help him develop into a man. You do everything you can, Mama, but you need to get some good men around you, uncles, grandparents, whoever, that your child can talk to, and talk to them about things that men need to know about, because you have no clue. I raised two boys. I had no clue, but God sent people into my life, to mentor my boys, for my boys to ask questions to. And those people are still in their lives now, and they're adults. So understand, you can't do it all by yourself. Understand, men trying to raise these young ladies, you are not going to understand what it feels to be a woman, what it feels to have your body changing and developing and going through all of these hormonal things that women have to go through. You're not going to understand that. That's why you need to have a good woman in your life. I'm not talking about a companion. I'm talking about a good woman that is willing to mentor your child. But you have to ask for those things. You can't be so prideful and try to do it all by yourself, because you're not going to be able to make it. You can't work and do all of that and still, you know, give your child everything they need. Ask for the help, you guys. Don't be so proudful. Don't be so proud, okay? And when things are out of control, you may even need to consult your pastor. You know, maybe he can sense something that's going on with your child. Maybe he can help you find the prayers that you need to pray for what you see your child going through. Sometimes we just get so frustrated and we get so mad because they're doing stuff that we know they know better than to do. Sometimes they are not always in control, you guys. Like I said before, the enemy is tempting them on every side, coming at them, introducing them to stuff that you don't even know about. Okay, things that they can't tell you about. They have to fight against those things because they know those things are wrong, but they can't tell you about it because they know that you're going to get upset with them or you're going to punish them. So understand, it's so much going on with our children. You need somebody else praying for them. You need somebody else speaking wisdom into them, speaking life into them. You can't do it all by yourself, so don't be so proud to ask for help. There's nothing wrong with asking for help, you guys. Hey, Lindsay. And then even if you are married and you have a family and y'all are going through some things, get the therapy you and your husband need so that your children don't have to be influenced by y'all's dysfunction. Because it's going to take two of y'all. It's going to take y'all working as a team to raise those children. So if y'all don't have y'all stuff together, how can you tell them what to do? So y'all need to get the help that you need and quit being stubborn thinking, oh, I don't want to tell them folks our business. Well, if y'all can't come together and get it together, it's going to affect your children. So get the therapy that you need as a couple so that y'all can come together and be what those children need. Okay? Don't be so prideful. Okay? And if your children are struggling in school, don't be embarrassed by that. Don't be embarrassed if that child has to stay back a grade simply because they can't keep up. Get that child the help that they need and quit worrying about what other people have to say. We are more than too much worried about what people have to say about us these days. You know, the best freedom in the world is not caring what other people think. And I don't know if it took me to get to a certain age to get there, but I'm thankful that I finally made it over that hump to where I don't care what you think. I know what's going on with me. I know what's going on with my children. I can't worry about you. I'm about them. I'm about making sure they have what they need. I'm about praying for them, keeping them covered. I can't worry about what y'all talking about, because this is a battle that we have to fight as a family. So you have to get your mind off worrying about what people are going to say and the stigmas and all of this and people saying that you're not a good parent. Know what's going on in your house. Take control of your environment and do something about those things you can. Pray about all the rest of it, okay? And number six, stop holding grudges with your ex. Stop holding grudges with somebody simply because they no longer want to be with you and you have a child with them. Stop trying to make that child be some kind of game piece between you and him. Oh, if you treat me this way, you get to see your child. Oh, this, that, and the other. Because you know what? You are destroying that child. You are destroying him from the inside out. Because it took two of y'all to tango to make that child. That child didn't have no say-so about coming here. So it's not fair for you to use that child as a way of hurting that other person. There's nothing right about that. We need to give up on that. If something didn't work out between you and that child's father, that's okay. come together to raise that child, because that child did not ask to be here. Stop with all the pettiness. Stop with all the taking things out on your child, you know, because you're frustrated with that other parent. You know, that's abuse. Stop making that child a part of your drama. That child did not ask to be here. That child has nothing to do with what went wrong with you and him. So we need to get our minds together and grow up and decide, okay, we have a child together. We need to do the best we can collectively so that this child turns out, you know, the best that he can, that he's healthy, that he doesn't have to go through some of the stuff that we went through. You know, we've got to grow up in our minds and stop worrying about that other person. If it didn't work, it didn't work. That's just plain and simple. You need to be mature enough to be that child's parent, both parent. A child needs both of their parents all the time. So a lot of times single parents, I know it hurts when that other parent is not there, but you know what? You can't make somebody be what they don't want to be. All you can do is pray for them. And you have to learn how to pray for people when you know that their mind is not right. When you know that they're out of God's will. When you know that they're doing things that wouldn't please God. You don't have to talk about them. Give them over to God and say, God, you know that this is this child's mother. And she should be doing this, that, and the other. God, I pray that you touch her and that you change her heart so that she could be the mother she needs to be. It's time out for talking about people. We need to start praying for people, because talking about people doesn't make anything better. Okay? Start praying for those people. Start praying what you want to see, and then make sure what you see or want to see lines up with God's word. Just like I said before, when we give our children back to God, it's not about what you want them to be, but you need to pray, God, help them to be what you want them to be. Because like I said before, God's got a plan for all of us. Children aren't supposed to be robots. They're not supposed to be, you know, their mother's, you know, vision for them or their father's vision for them. They're supposed to be their father's, okay, their original father's vision. And so we have to line our desires up with God's desires for our children and allow God's will to be done in their lives. So single parents, do not think that you're less than a parent just because you're by yourself. Things happen, okay? Trust me, I've been there. I've been married and I've been single with children. Trust me, things happen. Quit beating yourself up, because that time you're wasting feeling sorry for yourself, you could be focusing on being the best parent you can be for your child. Stop letting the world decide you're not good enough. You show up at that school just like the ones that have two parents. You show up with your head up, you're not ashamed, and be proud of who you are, because at least you're trying. At least you're trying to do the best that you can do. So don't feel bad about yourself, because while you may not have that other parent physically, you do have God on your side. That's why it's so important that you include God in your life and in your children's life and in the whole thing of parenting that you're having to do. Include God, because God will help you get through it. He'll help you understand how to do things you've never done before. And he'll give you that wisdom and that discernment, and he'll give you the knowledge to do some things, you know, and you won't even understand how I got from point A to point B. That's God. It's so many things with my children, and I couldn't even tell you who taught me how to be like this, or who taught me how to do this, or who taught me how to do that. That was nothing but God, because I wasn't raised like that. I raised my children different than how I was raised. I had to trust God to show me the way to go with my children. I had to. And he taught me things about my children and taught me how to be a parent. I had to learn how to be a parent. There's no book that teaches you how to be a parent. You learn it by faith, by faith, by faith, by praying to God and asking God to help you. And he will help you along the way. And my final thought, now that it's 2023, let's not go another day, another second, another minute without recognizing just how precious the gift of our children are. You know, people in the world that are stealing these kids, they put more value on our kids than we do. That's why they'll take penitentiary chances and snatch these kids, because they see a value that most of the times the parents don't even see. You know, we take so many things for granted. They're looking at them for monetary gain, but they know that your children are valuable. Nobody should see your children as more valuable than you. That's why it is so important that we protect them as much as we can from the enemy. And as parents, grandparents, aunts, and uncles, it's our job to protect them to the best of our ability. It's our job to pray for them. It's our job to look out for them and make sure that they are in a safe environment, to make sure that they feel loved, to make sure they feel good about themselves. That is not the teacher's job. That is our job as the parent to do those things. Because think about it, this is our future out there. And what you don't put in them is gonna matter. So everything you can give your children while you have them at home, give it to them. And I'm not talking about material things. I'm talking about teach them how to be a good human being. Teach them how to have humility. Teach them how to be grateful. Teach them how to love. So many of these kids don't even know how to love. They don't even know how to have a conversation. Come on, y'all. We have messed up somewhere letting these kids have these phones at the table. These kids don't even know how to talk to one another face to face. Don't know how to go on a date and talk face to face. We have messed up, you guys. We have got to turn these things around because these children are our future. And remember, it's not what you give them that matters as far as material things, but it's what we teach them and show them by the way we live our lives that's going to matter. That's what's going to make the difference. You leave them something. When you leave here, it's what you've given them and what you've shown them and what you've taught them on the inside that's going to matter. All this material stuff is not going to matter. That's what makes a person into a beautiful human being. It's not the physical stuff that's around them. It's about what's on the inside. So guys, that is our responsibility. That is our job. And that should be our pleasure to do that because our children were given to us as a gift by God. Thank you guys so much for watching tonight. I love you guys. I hope something I said touches some of you. You know, we all make mistakes. We all, you know, can look back on our parenting and say, you know what, I wish I'd have done this better or I wish I'd have done that better. But you know what? God always gives you another chance. Sometimes it's with another family member. Sometimes it's with grandchildren. Sometimes it's with a neighbor's child. God will always give you an opportunity to do whatever it is that you wish you would have done with your children. I think about that all the time. All the times I said this, that, and the other, there's always been a child that's come along that I could do that for, even when I couldn't do it for my own. So it's not always just about us, you guys, or about ours. We've got this whole big world, and there's all these children out here that need us, and it's our job to be there for them. God bless you guys. Thank y'all so much for watching. Have a great rest of the week. Love you guys. Please stay safe, stay COVID-free, and take care of yourselves. All right. Bye-bye.